Absence of light. We lived in the light once, briefly, but we pushed it away. Blinded by our desires, we didn't realize what we were doing. But in the end, we brought this darkness upon ourselves. It became our home. You live in the dark for so long, it becomes normal. Find yourself wondering if there ever really was a light to begin with. But as we struggled to make the best of our situation, deep down, somehow, we knew. We knew we were not meant to live in the dark. We were meant for more. Something unexpected happened. We woke up to a bright star shining in the darkness, almost as if it were lighting a path we were unaware of, drawing us to the light, illuminating what was once dark. We didn't know that we could trust it. Is this even real? But it was real. The sun had returned. Into our hearts with joy. A joy so unspeakable, so unimaginable, that all of creation lifted their voice in song to the one who returns with the light. A baby in a manger, the light in the darkness.
His name is Jesus. His name is you thankful Jesus is the light? Light shines in the darkness. We celebrate who he is today. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord appeared before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. But then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Jesus Christ, he is our King, and our King is he.
Sing it out. My life was surrounded by darkness. We grew up in church, whole family has been in church, deacons, pastors, bishops, all that. I enjoyed church to an extent, but it seemed like we were there all the time because my dad is a musician. So dad has to play, they have rehearsal, we have to be there. So we were the little pew babies. Went to go get some water and rehearsal was still going on. The youth were the only ones there. And at the time, it was the drummer. He came out and he got really close to me and I was like, okay, what are you doing? Like, it's so foreign to me. I'm like, okay, so I pushed him back. I wasn't able to defend myself. That's when he raped me. Nobody at church heard me and I didn't say nothing about it. I was broken. My heart was broken because I'm supposed to be in a safe place, so I resented going to church. With a family member, it happened again. First, the church is something I hold dear to me. Then family, this is something I hold dear to me, and they both have broken me. And it drew me into like a very, very deep depression. I wanted to take my own life. I felt like I was in the desert and all by myself. Nobody was there and I'm looking around for help and just hopeless. I started hanging out with some friends. They introduced me to drinking. I hadn't drank before. Ooh, I'm in college, let's try this. Started smoking marijuana and I was like, okay, this is nice. I can still function. Hey, I actually got an A+ on that test and I didn't study. This might be the drug of choice now, from now on. It made me feel good, so it gave me a sense of acceptance. My relationship with God was non-existent. I always believed, hey, if I just say, I'm sorry, God, then I'm okay. And it wasn't until I became friends with a really good friend now that she accepted me for just being who I was, even past all the stuff that I was doing. She saw something more in me. I started attending church with her. I started enjoying it. I started having a relationship with God for myself. Before I turned back to God, I felt like I was underwater trying to hold my breath for a decade. Coming back to God was coming to the surface, being able to actually breathe, being able to be free and knowing that I don't have to resent what happened to me. I can actually forgive them. I can forgive myself. Life now has given me a greater appreciation for God. It's given me a deeper appreciation for my family, my friends. To have a relationship with God is something that can never be taken away from you. Even in the darkest of the darkest moments, that God is still there.
For a miracle, the heart. There was no glimmer of light. There was no glimmer of hope. There was nothing. I was just fought depression, even at a super young age. I just didn't like me. Fourth, fifth grade, and I remember contemplating suicide. And it wasn't just like a fleeting thought that happened once or twice. It was literally something that plagued me. And so I was a senior in high school and going to church and talking to my parents. I wanted to give God a try. It was almost like this contract with God. It was like, if you make my life better, I'll serve you. And you got 3 months to pull it off. I expected to be free from depression and free from anxiety and free from hating myself. I expected that God was kind of like a genie that, well, I did what you said, like make everything better. And it didn't work. Remember, there's this one day, I was a senior in high school and I'm walking onto the football field, just talking to God. I said, God, you know what? Like, I've tried it your way. I don't like life anymore. I'm not any happier. I'm not any better. And I'm gonna do whatever I want and I don't need you. That was the decision that led to the darkest 3 years of my life. You know, one night I was at this party and I was on drugs and ended up meeting up with my girlfriend and we get in this huge fight. And I just drove away by myself, just so mad. And I saw a light pole and I had this thought that I should just kill myself. I was going, I don't know, 35, 40 miles an hour, didn't touch the brakes, just hit the pole. I come to and I just see this giant puddle of blood. And I just honestly thought I was gonna die. They ended up putting about 100 stitches in my face. You would think after such a near-death experience that things would have gotten better or would have like had this wake-up call, and it just got worse. Did more drugs and partied more and wanted nothing to do with God. You know, even though I turned my back on God, it just seemed like I was just actively pursuing me and just letting me know that even though I turned my back on him, he hadn't turned his back on me. My mom starts going to these prayer meetings and she's praying for me to get saved. And there's this lady at this prayer meeting that basically told my mom, she says, you have a son, he's called to ministry and he's in this relationship and that relationship's gonna end and that he's gonna surrender and he's gonna follow Jesus. They'd recorded it on a cassette tape. My mom plays the tape for me and I listen to it. And she's like, Justin, that's you. It was the decision that I've debated making my whole life and tried to make and wrestled with and always knew I would. And then finally, I just surrendered. It was in that moment that all the darkness and all the self-hatred that I had for years was just gone. And I was filled with light and I was filled with hope. And so since making that decision, I just wanted to help as many people as I could because I know the darkness that was in me. I know the hopelessness that was in me. And I just want people to find the freedom and find the hope that I found in Jesus.
the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No.
Well, hey, good morning, Twin Rivers. I hope you guys are having an awesome Sunday so far. Have you enjoyed this so far? You've enjoyed Light in the Darkness? Awesome. Well, hey, if we haven't had the chance to meet yet, my name's Justin Goodson. I'm one of the pastors on staff here. Man, I'm so glad that you're here with us this Sunday. I know that you could be anywhere, but hey, you're here with us, and I mean, we're just so glad that you are. If you are new around here, I do want to challenge you to do something, and it's simple. Take the three-week challenge. And this is where you just give us 3 weeks in a row, and we just believe that at the end of those 3 weeks, you'll know if Twin Rivers is the church family for you. Because here's the deal, every service is a little different. If you came here today for the first time, we don't normally do big old productions like this. I hope you're enjoying it, but come back next week and you'll see what a normal service is like or a regular service is like. And so give us those 3 weeks.
Also, in the seat pocket in front of you, there's a prayer card. We know the holiday seasons are full of fun, but a lot of times they're full of a little bit of stress. And so we would just love the opportunity to pray for you, to pray for your family this holiday season. So take the card out of the seat pocket in front of you. Give us a little bit of information about you. Most importantly, give us your prayer request. And we would just love the opportunity just to pray for you this holiday season. I'm gonna have our ushers come forward for our time of giving. You know, coming up in just a couple weeks, we have our Christmas Eve services. These are an absolute blast. We just have so much fun with these. These are kind of our more traditional service, if you will, for the holiday season. There'll be some Christmas carols and there'll be a candlelight moment. So it just, I want to challenge you to make it part of your holiday traditions this year that you come to a Twin Rivers Christmas Eve service. We actually added a whole nother service. So there's a 4 o'clock service. There's also a 6 p.m. service. So you want to be sure to be here for one of those. I'm gonna have our ushers go ahead and pass the buckets for their giving. And as they do that, I just wanted to tell you a story. You know, at Twin Rivers, we're all about giving back to our community. We're always trying to figure out new ways to reach people and to help people. And really the motive for that is simple. God has just done so much in our lives individually that we just can't help but give back and to help other people. And so just a couple weeks ago, we did a breakfast with Santa, and it was the biggest one we'd ever done. There were over 1,200 people who were here. It was absolutely incredible. But this year, we wanted to add something special to it. We wanted to add something unique to it. So on Friday night, we opened up a special event just for families with children with special needs. And so we opened up that event, and it was just an incredible, over 30 families came, and they just had a blast. They got a free picture of Santa, and our teams just did an incredible job serving them and loving them and caring for them. You know, some of the feedback we get a lot of times from families with children with special needs is a lot of times they just feel like forgotten and kind of overlooked. And so they just have unique circumstances. And a lot of times people just forget about that or don't think about it. But we went out of our way to make sure they felt loved and included this holiday season. So why don't you guys give yourselves a hand for that? It's just an incredible, incredible event. Such an awesome time. So let me pray for you as we continue of Light in the Darkness production. Father, we just thank you for today. God, we just pray that you bless every single person who gave, that helps us expand your kingdom to reach more people. We pray that you continue to change lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, get ready, sit back, relax, and we'll continue Light in the Darkness.
Was upon the face of the deep, and the spirit.
There's no darkness in your eyes. There's no question in your mind, God Almighty, God of mercy.
There's no hiding from your face. There's no striving in your grace, God of mercy, God Almighty. Let there be
regret in what it costs, God of
light that shines above. Become the light that shines in us. There's no darkness in your way, so have your way.
Come back to close it out in just a minute with a really inspiring number, but I wanted to share with you for a few seconds because I realize that many of you come today from different spaces and places in life. I realize all of you are asking how long I've mentored those dancers, and I'm very proud of them. I feel like they're all able to do exactly what I taught them. So, I want to share a few thoughts with you. It was June 2002 when a very particular darkness entered into the neighborhood of Fairdale Heights in Salt Lake City, Utah. That night began a nine-month darkness for a girl named Elizabeth as she was abducted from her home. She was regularly abused, held captive, and regularly fed fearful lie after fearful lie so that she would not try to escape. And the horror that she endured over those 9 months is hard for us to fathom. But the truth is that darkness has a way of finding us all. You know, yours may, it just comes around that our captors have different names. For some of you, it's an addiction. For some of you, it's a depression. For some, it's a marriage that's very broken, and for others, it's a situation in your family. For some, it's a diagnosis, and even for some of you here today, it's the fact that no matter what you've done, you continue to be in a season of struggle financially, can never get your head above water. And then for some, it doesn't appear as evident as others, but it's a dissatisfaction, a hole in the heart of every person that ultimately cannot be filled with anything you've ever found. And it's not because we haven't tried. We've tried to break the chain of the darkness. We've tried to escape. But lo and behold, the freedom we desire is never found. And the reason that I think this story is so compelling is because over as I studied it out, one of the things that Elizabeth's captors did is that they meticulously tried to separate her from her God-given identity. They changed her name, they changed her hair, they changed her routines, they changed her clothes, because what captivity does is it eventually wants you to take it on as your identity. And that's what happens to us when we start to say things like, this is the way it'll always be. I'll always be an addict. I'm never going to be able to change. I'm always going to struggle with the same things I've struggled with. This is just my lot in life. Some people are meant to be happy. Other people are not meant to be happy. We take it on as our identity. And it's during that time that darkness wants us to settle into our struggle, and it wants us to accept what we haven't been able to change in our own strength. But it's also the reason that 2,000 years ago, Jesus came on the scene and boldly proclaimed to the darkness, I am the light of the world. Any who follow me will no longer live in darkness, but they will get to live in the light of life. But here's the problem. If you've been in darkness long enough, it's hard to muster faith in Jesus' words. If you've lived with depression or addiction or struggle long enough, it's easy to just believe this, that Jesus is the light of the world, but that doesn't apply to my world. That my dysfunction is too far, that my choices have already been made, that my marriage is too broken. And the reason I bring that up is because the clearest indicator that darkness has set domain in your life is that you live life with an overbearing sense of doubt. That you just don't really believe that things could get better. That there's just this strong doubt that is pervasive through your life and the way that you look at life and that you just believe that it is what it is and that it will always be what it is. But the reason that I bring that up is because we care so much about you. I care about you. Everyone here today cares about you. And what we want to do today is sound the alarm to that settling and to remind you that if you are arguing with the one who put the stars in the sky about his ability to do certain things, darkness has you duped. I mean, after all, if God can put can cause a virgin to give birth, he can birth a new season in your life. If God can raise the dead, then he can raise you out of depression. I mean, if God is able to feed thousands with a few fish and bread, he can feed new ideas to restart your career. Listen, if God was able to overcome all sin and was able to put back together our relationship with him with just two beams and a few nails, he can put your life back together as well. Don't let doubt force feed you. God is still able to pull you out of what you're dealing with. He's able to do it. But the problem is that doubt wants to argue. Doubt wants to argue that you're too far gone, that there's no freedom in sight. And doubt wants you to believe that you don't have enough faith for God to do something. Well, if there's anything I've learned is you don't have to have a whole lot of faith for God to do something. As a matter of fact, he said, as much as a little bit of a mustard seed worth of faith, and I can do something extremely substantial in your life. So here's the truth. Elizabeth's story tells us this, that a simple step of faith is all you need to find freedom. A simple step of faith, it's all you need. Because on March 17th of 2003, she and her captors were leaving a local Walmart. And as they were crossing the street, some policemen noticed the odd-looking group, and they stopped them to question them. One officer questioned her captor, and the other officer pulled Elizabeth aside and began to question her. And he asked her this question, "What is your name?" Immediately, Elizabeth froze in fear at the thought of what her captor would do to her if she said who she really was. And so as she's going back and forth in her mind, the officer asks again, "Excuse me, what is your name?" But at this time, her captor glared over at her, inciting more fear in her heart. And at just about the time that Elizabeth was about to claim her captive identity and go along with her captor's story and lie, the officer got down on one knee. He put his hand gently on her shoulder. He looked her in the eye, and he said, "You're Elizabeth Smart, aren't you, sweetheart?" And she said that was the moment that changed everything. Because he had spoken into the truth of who she really was, and for something on the inside of her leaped, and for the first time in a long time, she believed she could be free. Immediately, she looked at him and said, "I am Elizabeth." Her captor was immediately arrested. She was completely saved, and that day her darkness ended. Listen, do you know why that's so powerful? Because 2,000 years ago, God got into flesh and got down on our level, and he looked us straight in the eyes, even though our sin glares at us to take our captive identity, and he says, "You are not your struggle. You are not your failures. You are not your past. You are not what you have done. You are not the days that you have messed up. You are my child, and doubt is not your nature, and darkness is not your home, and I came so that you could live free, an abundant life like you were created to live." And it leaps on the inside of us when we're reminded that darkness is not our home, but there is a light, and that light's name is Jesus. It leaps something. Just a little bit of faith starts to grow, and that little bit of faith is enough for you to agree with what God has said about you. That's all you've got to do is agree with him. That's all Elizabeth did is agree. As a matter of fact, that's what Romans 10:9 says. It says, if you openly declare or openly agree that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, like Elizabeth, you will be saved. See, Elizabeth didn't need a lot of faith. She just needed enough to stop agreeing with the darkness and to start agreeing with the God who came to save her life. And so that's what I want to give you an opportunity to do. It doesn't take a lot of faith. It takes enough faith to take a single step to usher in a whole new season of freedom. And so today I want to give you the opportunity to make that step. And so I'm going to ask, would you, everyone here, would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Just as a point of reflection. And what I want to do is I want to give you an opportunity to do exactly what Romans 10:9 said. I don't know what kind of darkness you're facing. The truth is only you and God know the depths of it. But as you've seen through these stories and these songs, there is no darkness so dark that Jesus doesn't shine in it. And so what I want to do is give you an opportunity to take that step of faith and to openly declare, to openly agree that you are not what your captivity says you are. You are not an addict. I'm giving you an opportunity to say, I'm not going to be spiritually despondent the rest of my life. I'm not going to be in this struggle always. I am a child of God. I want to give you that opportunity. And so the way I'm going to let you exercise your faith is I'd love to pray for you today. But obviously, there's so many people here that we don't have the ability to stand face to face. And so I'd like to just put a face with my prayer. And so if you're here today and you would say, Pastor Joe, I want you to pray for me. I'm choosing today to step out of darkness into light. I'm choosing today to follow Jesus. I'm choosing today to agree that I am his follower, his child. I am choosing to follow him. If that's you, and you say, Pastor Joe, today I want you to pray for me. I'm choosing that moment. I'm taking this step of faith. Why don't we do this? Why don't you just, no one's looking around. No one's going to embarrass you. Why don't you just wave at me so I can put a face? I'll take the time. I see that hand. Just wave at me. Pastor Joe, pray for me. I'm choosing. I see that hand. I see that hand and that hand. Come on, I'm going to look for you. There you go. I want to see your face. I see you right there. Yep. Pastor Joe, pray for me. I'm choosing today to exercise my faith. I'm stepping out. Yep. Got you right there and right there. I'm coming towards the middle and I'm looking for you. Anybody else? Yep. Got you right there. I see you. Pastor Joe, pray for me. Yep. I see you right there. Pastor Joe, pray for me. I'm looking over to this side of the room now. Come on. Just wave at me. Pastor Joe. Yep. I see you. Pray for me today. Pray for me. Yep. I got you. I'm exercising my faith. Anybody else? I see you right there. Anybody else? I see you all the way over there. Yep. Now I'm going to look in the balcony and I need you to stick it up high so I can see you. Pastor Joe, pray for me today. I see that hand and I see that one. And Pastor, pray for me today. I'm taking this step of faith. Anybody else? Come on, just wave at me. Just wave at me. Stepping out of darkness into the light. Into the light. I see that one. Yep. And I see that one too. One final pass for anybody I've missed. If I missed you, come on, just take the time. I want to pray for you. I want to see your face. Anybody else? I'm looking for you. I feel like there's one more. Come on, wave at me. Where you at? I see you somewhere. Come on, where you at? Yep, yeah, I got you. Now, here's what I want to do. If you just prayed that, if you just raised your hand and waved at me and I just saw your face, I want to lead you in this prayer. I want you to look to the screens right now. Now, I want us to pray together right now. This is how you're exercising your faith. This is how Elizabeth agreed with who she was. Here we go, together. Here we are. Heavenly Father, I admit that I am a sinner and that I am lost without you. I believe Christ died in my place, making a way for us to have a relationship, and I choose to follow Jesus and his way for the rest of my life. Father, a miracle has taken place. Captivity has ended. New life has begun, and your love is pouring into these hearts. So, Lord Jesus, today may you do a miracle in them that the darkness be bound and the light released in their hearts. May the love of God overwhelm them, and may God, they never, ever, ever be the same. Not that you just came as a historical moment 2,000 years ago to establish Christmas, but may they always remember it as the day you came for them in this Christmas. So Lord, we love you and we commit this to you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Come on, can we celebrate all the folks who just made that decision? I mean, that's a big deal. It's a big deal. Awesome. Now listen, this is extremely important. So this is extremely important. If you just raise your hand and pray that prayer with me, please give me your attention. We are here to help you. That's literally the whole reason this place exists. And the best way that we've discovered after people have made this decision is we've discovered the next 40 days are pivotal in you being able to launch into your faith and not be drawn back into captivity. And so here's what we've done is we've put together a gift for you. It's a box, and we call it the 40-Day Challenge. Inside, we isolate the Bible verses that'll help you in the next 40 days. We also give you a book that's written out so that you just read a few pages every 40 days, and it starts to answer some of the questions you have. It's got some other gifts in there, and listen, it's got a checklist of the things that will help you take steps as you're growing this new faith that you have. I just wish that it would exist when I made this decision. We want to invest that in you. And it's completely free. So here's what we're going to do. In the seat back in front of you, if you'll just pull out the card that's in the seat back in front of you, and you'll just put your name and maybe an email on that card. You take that card, and as you're exiting at every door, as you're exiting, there'll be people there with those boxes. We know you got lunch to get to or brunch or whatever you got going on. You just hand them that card. They give you a box, and then we'll send you an email and just tell you that we're here to help. I promise we will not hassle you, but we want to give this to you. So right now, come on, don't argue with me. I'm the one with the mic. I can keep us here till like 2 o'clock, all right? Just pull the card out. Go ahead and fill it out right now. And as you exit at these doors, you're going to be given that box. It's our gift from you. We're here for you, and I'm so proud of you. So it's going to be great. Now, are you guys ready to jump back into light in the darkness? They got a great, great number coming back. It's going to be awesome.
Can we all just stand just for a couple of minutes and, first of all, celebrate again those who just gave their hearts to Christ, amen? And I thought there's no way we could leave today without having a little bit of time where we could all sing together. So I want us to all join in to sing this wonderful Christmas classic, Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Wonders of his love.
wonderful. Will you please be seated?